I'm Pastor Michelle. Pastor Laura and I would like to welcome you to Renton United Methodist Church. We continue with our Easter season because Easter isn't just one day. It is the message of God's desire for us to live fully every day. The early church practiced their hope in this way. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having goodwill of all the people. We'll use this verse to structure our worship experience this morning. We'll spend time together in this virtual temple we have made of Facebook and YouTube and the many, many helping hands bringing us together. We'll break open, if not our literal bread in our homes, we'll break open the scripture in our hearts so that God can move through and within us. We'll praise God and we'll follow the risen Christ along the road that leads us to act in goodwill toward all of creation. Let us begin with this song we introduced last week and allows us to hear God's words calling to us for this day and then respond in our words, answering God's call.
Set our heart stones in our sacred space. And now join me in an attitude of prayer as our liturgist leads us in the opening prayer this morning.
Good morning. My name is Steve Morse. I'm your liturgist this morning. Let's pray together. Divine breath, you touch our souls with your healing. You satisfy our longings with your love. You forgive our mistakes through your grace. You connect us when we feel isolated. You grieve with us while we are hurt. Help us to recognize you on the roads we walk, so that in our hurt, longing, or isolation, we are never alone. Amen.
Welcome, children. I need your help today. You know, we're invited to follow Jesus, and so I need to pick a pair of shoes to wear today, and I need some help. And my dogs, Snow White and Beckerel, are no help because they don't even like to wear shoes. Now that we're staying home, I like to wear slippers. But I can't wear slippers outside. It's raining today, so maybe rain boots. Well, I don't really have rain boots, but I don't know. Maybe this would work. What do you think? I was talking to Pastor Laura, and she told me that her feet often hurt, so she likes to wear Birkenstocks. but I don't have a pair of Birkenstocks. Oh, but I do have sandals. Maybe I could wear these. What do you think about this? Or I really like to wear these. These are very pretty shoes, and I like to wear pretty shoes. The only problem with these shoes is that they're not very comfortable, and I can't walk very far. Well, maybe I need to tell you where we need to go, and then you can help me pick a little bit more easily. In just a few minutes, we're going to hear a scripture where a few of Jesus' disciples were on the road from Jerusalem to Emmaus. They were very sad. Jesus had died. And they were also confused because some of the women in their group had seen a risen Jesus, and they didn't know what to think. While they were walking, a stranger joined them on this road and walked with them all the way to Emmaus. They told the stranger about their sadness and their confusion. The stranger listened to them. When they got to Emmaus, they invited the stranger to come to their house and have dinner with them. And as they were sitting down and breaking bread, it was in that moment that they recognized that that stranger who walked with them all along on that road was Jesus. We are invited to walk with Jesus. And so that's why I need some help today picking a pair of shoes. Now, as I'm thinking about it, it needs to be comfortable and it needs to be a good walking shoe. And it should protect my feet so that I can walk a long distance. So, maybe these? What do you think about these? Although, you know, now that I think about it, I think that it's okay if we wear slippers or sandals or Birkenstocks or rain boots or walking shoes or pretty shoes. Because it doesn't matter what kind of shoes we are wearing, we still walk with Jesus because Jesus walks with us wherever we go. He walks with us when we're sad or when we're happy or when we're angry or confused. He walks with us when we're excited and calm and at peace. Jesus is just always with us, just as he was with the disciples on the road. And Jesus invites us to walk with him, as well as follow him. I guess the type of shoe that we are going to pick is going to depend on where we're planning to go that day. So, what kind of shoe do you like to wear? What kind of shoe will you wear when you walk with Jesus and follow Jesus? Will you please pray with me? Dear God, we're so glad that Jesus walks with us wherever we are going. We're so glad that Jesus walks with us however we're feeling. Help us to recognize Jesus and to remember that we are not alone. Amen.
The gospel lesson today comes from Luke chapter 24, beginning at verse 13. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb earlier this morning. When they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things, and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them all the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told them what had happened on the road, and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Have you ever played the game Mother May I? When I was a kid, it was one of my favorite games. I used to play it a lot with my friends and my little brother. This morning, I want to change it up a little bit and make it Pastor May I. And I want to play it with you a few rounds right now. It might be a little bit difficult given the way that we're worshiping right now, but I think we're going to be able to do it. So the way it works is that I'll turn around and I'll listen for your questions. And when I hear one, I'll say either yes or no. If I say yes, you can go ahead and do it. And if I say no, then I might offer an alternative instead. So are you ready? Here we go. I'm going to turn around. I'm listening for your questions. Oh, I hear one of you asking if you can go get your slippers and wear your slippers to church. Yes, you may. Very good. You're doing very well with this game. Want to try another round? All right, here we go. Oh, I hear someone asking if they can take giant steps along the road. Yes, you may. Very good. All right, we have one more round. Are you ready? Here goes. I hear someone saying, "Pastor, may I just go back to church and worship how we used to?" No, we can't do that. It's not time now for us to go back to church and to worship like we used to. But it is time for us to continue to come up with creative ways to worship together virtually and to support each other in this time. So that's enough for our game at this point. The reason that I thought of that game this week, though, is that I feel like the disciples in the story that we just heard might have felt a little bit like that game. For them, it might not have been "Pastor, may I?" It might have been "Rabbi, may I?" They might have asked questions like, "Rabbi, may I go to the tomb? Rabbi, may I see your hands? Rabbi, may I touch your side? Rabbi, may I make you dinner? Rabbi, may I go home? Rabbi, may I expect that things are going to return to normal anytime soon?" Those disciples, Cleopas and the unnamed Jesus follower who met Jesus on the road, were exhausted and discouraged. They had been through a lot that week. They had hoped that Jesus would be the one to free the Jews from Roman occupation, and he didn't do it. Their hopes were smashed. If they couldn't have what they hoped for, they just wanted to go home. They probably wanted to go back to their normal lives and their families. Maybe they said, "Let's just get on with it." The other disciples, the fishermen, probably wanted to get back to fishing. The businessmen wanted to get back to their businesses. This Jesus thing hadn't panned out the way they thought, but he was gone now, so they could go back to business as usual, right? Well, the story on the road to Emmaus answers that question. In the story, the disgruntled disciples tell this person that they don't know about their experience. And he responds with all the ways that Jesus has fulfilled the scriptures. When they finally recognize him over dinner, they realize that things are not going back to normal. Things will never be the same. The fishermen are not going back to fishing, and the businessmen will not return to their businesses. even Cleopas and Cleopas's friend who was on the road don't get to go home and do life as usual. Instead, after dinner, they put their walking shoes back on and they head back to Jerusalem to live into this new reality. The risen Jesus has changed the plan. The answer to their "Rabbi, may I go home?" question was no, but you may spread God's good news and transform the lives of all you meet with that good news. In fact, I will leave you my peace and I will give you the Holy Spirit to go with you so that you have help. It's probably no surprise to readers of Luke that when we get to this point at the end of the book, it's about a reversal. Throughout the gospel, Luke has been telling his readers that things aren't ever going to be the same. His book is all about reversals. Luke is, after all, the one who brought us the Magnificat at Christmas time, where Mary sings about the last being first and the first being last. Mary in that song is actually picking up on themes that Luke has borrowed from the Hebrew scriptures, especially Hannah's song when she was pregnant with Samuel. The idea of God bringing about reversals and things not being the same as they are, as they were, goes way, way back. If you think back all the way to Noah's Ark or Jonah in the belly of the whale, or the Israelites finding the promised land, these are examples of when God's people may have asked, "God, may we just go back to normal?" And God said, "No, things are not going back to normal. But you may be my people, and I will be your God, and we'll walk the road together into our new reality." I don't know about you, but I can certainly relate to wanting things to go back to normal. I admit to having questions like, "Governor, may I just teach my classes from my classroom?" Or, "Bishop, may we just come together with a way for people to worship from a safe distance, but still together?" Or, "District Superintendent, may I serve two congregations who want to be one, and let's make them one." The end of each of those questions that I didn't say, of course, is so things can be a little more normal. And by now you know the answer, especially if you were here with us last week when Pastor Michelle preached on Jesus' words to his disciples when he first appeared. Jesus' answer to the disciples and to us is no. You may not go back to normal. Instead, Jesus says, "My peace I give to you, and the Holy Spirit I give to you, to see you into the new reality." Going back to normal is never God's way. We are called to become something new. We are called to become Easter people, people shaped by the resurrection of Jesus, by the risen Christ, by our encounter with the risen Christ. We are called to walk the resurrection way. And that is hardly what the disciples wanted to hear, and if we're honest, we might not want to hear that ourselves either. Jesus offers them peace, not because they're already so peaceful, but because they need it. Same for us. We need that peace in order to walk this way with God. It's hard to name exactly how we have been changed by Easter this year. It's hard to know how we will be a different people when we come back together. But if we can name this stay-at-home time during COVID-19 as a wilderness time, or a belly of the whale time, or a Sabbath time, or a death and resurrection time, if we can name it as a reversal, then we know that God will transform us through it. Working from home may be more commonplace. Maybe that's one of the transformations. Perhaps I will be transformed as a teacher so that I can offer distance learning to my students as an accommodation in ways that I couldn't have done before. Perhaps mask wearing will become much more commonplace, not as a sign of danger around, but instead as a fashion statement for sure, and also as a sign of extended caring for those around us in case we might be contagious. I hope you will help me to name other ways that we are being transformed, that we are being grown by the grace of God during these days. I encourage you to reflect this week and in the coming weeks about how, as Easter people, we recognize new birth, even through this time, even in us. I'll point to a few more ways that you don't have to agree with. I just offer them as conversation starters. I hope you have your own ideas about where God is bringing new life in you. And I don't want to rush directly to the resurrection. I have to acknowledge that death comes before the resurrection and that we are still grieving so much loss around us. That is real and true. And we know the promise that comes, that after death comes resurrection. And so I encourage us to start thinking about where those points are. Personally, I hope that we are being called to deepen our faith and our understanding of God's purpose for our lives. I hope that we are constantly becoming new in God's eyes. For those of us who are part of Renton UMC, I believe we are being called to be church in new ways. For our community, we are called to tell of the risen Christ even in times of hardship. We'll hear Nancy Gillespie in just a few minutes give us an example of seeing glimpses of the risen Christ through her mask-making ministry. And also for our church, we are meeting new people through our online ministry, our online presence. People are finding it safe to visit churches, and they are looking for a connection to what is holy and good. And as we engage in ministry with those who have found us through our online presence, we will be made new by the grace of God and the gifts that are made manifest in those who join us. And beyond our church, for the city of Renton, Pastor Michelle and I went to a meeting this week with the Sunset pastors, the pastors who are serving churches in the Sunset neighborhood. And we heard this week how the churches are working beyond just the people who used to come and sit in their pews to bring everyone into an experience of the common good. How churches and Sustainable Renton are finding ways so that multiple evenings a week there can be drive-up food distribution that fills the trunk of people who have found themselves with food insecurity due to loss of income and not being able to work. We heard how churches have reached out to those who need safe shelter in order to provide social distance as well. We shared how our members have been knit together in so many ways, but this week in the phone tree as another manifestation of that knitting together. After these new ways that the churches have been leading towards the common good, we won't go back to how we were before. Church in Renton has been changed for the good. This week we also celebrated Earth Day. The forces of resurrection have been let loose in creation. Animals have returned to habitats long abandoned. Water and air is cleaner than it has been for generations. As tragic as this virus and stay-at-home time has been, and again, I don't want to make light of that, as tragic as it has been in terms of lives lost and livelihoods lost, there's also the beginning of a glimmer of blessing that we may yet learn how to coexist on this planet with the rest of creation. And so I hope that as we seek to move into a new time, a post-COVID-19 time, that we will make it a resurrection time for creation and not another crucifixion. As we move into a time when we recognize more and more our effects on the rest of the planet, let's make our impact one that brings life and not death. The story of the walk to Emmaus reminds us that going back to what seemed normal is not possible after the resurrection. We are Easter people. There's a poem by a poet named Julia Esquivel de Velasquez. It's called Threatened by Resurrection. That concept just struck me this week, threatened by resurrection. In what ways does resurrection threaten us? Listen to the last few lines of her poem. To dream awake, to keep watch asleep, to live while dying, and to know ourselves already resurrected. to dream awake, to keep watch asleep, to live while dying, and to know ourselves already resurrected. She wrote in the midst of violence and oppression of native populations in her native Guatemala. And as I think about these words, I think that the threat of resurrection is that we don't get to go back to normal. We will dream awake and keep watch in our sleep for the new way that God is bringing forth. Because to be an Easter people is to know that God isn't through with us yet, and that we are always being formed into something new, even if it's scary. So this week, when we see the risen Christ on the road, or when we find that we've been walking with the risen Christ unaware, our job, like the job of the disciples on the road to Emmaus, is to notice that our hearts are warm. Our job is to accept the gifts of peace and the Holy Spirit that are offered to us, and then to stop seeking the old normal. We might ask, Rabbi, may I? But instead of asking, may I go home and pretend that this never happened, let's ask, may I be worthy of the new life that you are bringing about through me for your people. Amen.
Guide my feet while I run this race. Guide my feet while I run this race. Guide my feet while I run this race, for I don't want to run this race in vain.
I'm your child while I run this race. I'm your child while I run this race. I'm your child while I run this race, for I don't want to run this race in vain. Search my heart while I run this race. Search my heart while I run this race. Search my heart while I run this race, for I don't want to run this race in vain. Guide my feet while I run this race. Guide my feet while I run this race. Guide my feet while I run this race, for I don't want to run this race in vain.
I'm pleased to share a story about a project our church quilting group has been working on. When we heard the call to provide hospital workers with homemade face masks, our group went into high gear. To a person, we eagerly embraced the opportunity to serve as our faith directs us to do. We are called to love one another, and what better way to show love than to help provide protective gear to others in the middle of a pandemic? We started sewing. 7 quilters have made and given away over 900 masks. They have been received with gratitude and relief. We have given masks to family, friends, neighbors, church members, and total strangers, to several area hospitals, as well as medical facilities in Spokane and Anchorage, to long-term care facilities, metro bus drivers, chemo patients, essential tech workers, Starbucks workers, and Pastor Ed and Pastor Flora, and more. Countless stories in the Bible give us examples of showing compassion in a time of need. Honoring the message from those stories, we continue to make more face masks. We have participated in a small way in the hope for a better tomorrow by sharing our gifts and talents in an extraordinary time of need. Thank you.
Let us pray. We are going to center our hearts as one to begin. Let's take a deep breath together. I invite you to place your hand on your heart. Holy, living God, heartbeat of creation, help us to take this time to center on you. For you made us, you gave us life, and you continue to be with us every moment, every breath, every step. We are thankful today for Earth Day and creation, for 21st birthdays, for healing, and for finished cancer treatments. We are thankful for the making and sharing of face masks in our community, and the gift of connection as we remember that everyone has something that they need and everyone has something to offer. We are thankful for Zoom and phone calls and our connection with our family and friends in new ways in this time apart. We are thankful for opportunities to serve you and our community. We continue to pray for those in our community who are ill. We pray for healing for people who are sick with COVID-19, as well as other illnesses or injuries. We are thankful that the number of people who are infected with COVID-19 continues to go down in our state, and we pray that that may be so in other states and other nations. We pray for the health of those who are working on the front lines, the healthcare workers, firefighters, police, grocery store workers, Amazon warehouse folk, delivery people, and those who are providing essential services that are unseen. We pray for those who are struggling today, those who feel isolated, those who are depressed and are feeling anxious, those who are alone in the hospital, and their families who wish they could be with their loved ones, those who are grieving, those who have lost their job, those who are struggling to file unemployment claims and cannot get onto the website, those who are worried that they may lose their housing, those who have food insecurities, those who are trying to work at home and homeschool their children at the same time, and those whom we have not named but struggle in other ways. We pray that all who are struggling will feel your presence and the support of the community around them. We pray for our world. We pray for healing and health and peace. And most of all, we pray for your shalom. We lift all of our prayers to you, including the prayers that we have prayed silently in our heart. And now we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's take another breath of spirit as our final amen. We know that God hears our prayers, and the spirit, breath of God, is blowing from within us outward as a spirit of compassion and presence, even as we pray.
At this point in our service, I'd like to ask you to consider giving generously and prayerfully to your church. Your church is still dependent on your contributions. Both the North Campus and the South Campus addresses are secure places to mail your checks. It is also possible to give online through the church website, rfumc.org. Your contributions, your pledges, your generous giving to your church allows the church to be the arms and the legs of Jesus in the community, helping those who are in need. We thank you.
We now turn to the third movement in our worship service, where we praise God. Let's start with this prayer, the prayer that we say each week of this season. We know that Jesus is present among us, even in this very home. We will not let fear be louder than love, but with glad hearts and rejoicing souls, we will sing God's praise, for we are Easter people. Now, let's sing this great hymn. If you start to feel it, it's good to get up and dance your praises as we sing. Let us sing, He Lives.
I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever man may say. See His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer, and just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know. Christian, lift up your voice and sing eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. Walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives within my heart.
And now in this final movement of our worship service, we move toward the actions that we will take as a result of our goodwill towards all of creation. I hope that you will continue to walk your neighborhoods looking for the risen Christ, and that you will continue to walk in your homes, knowing that the risen Christ walks with you. And more than any of that, I hope that you will continue to spread the news of the risen Christ wherever you go. And now I invite you to speak the words of the benediction aloud with me. You can speak them to anyone who can hear them in your house or out your window, or speak them aloud to yourself, because these words are words that we all need to hear and that need to become a part of our reality. Join with me. God is always with you, no matter what you face, no matter what trials or hardships come your way. God is right beside you, offering love straight from the heart, guiding and directing your path. So acknowledge your fear and your worry, and know it as true and holy as any feeling, including joy and hope and love. Take heart. This is the heart of the matter. Amen.